Steps to life is opening God's word with you.
Jesus is coming again. Are you ready for his soon return?
Jesus Christ is always what we'll share with you.
We need a refreshing, so drink. Jesus is the water of life.
Steps to life, a work of love, a work of love.
He created this earth and wants to recreate you.
He can change your life.
I've studied this subject in other parts, a long ways away from here. And I've wanted to study this subject with you for some time. And if you have your Bible, I want to invite you to open it to 1 Timothy 1. And I want to read with you, why did Jesus come to this world? 1 Timothy, the first chapter. First Timothy, the first chapter, and the 15th verse. It says, "The word is faithful and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I myself am in first place." Why did Jesus come to this world? He came to this world to save sinners. Sinners. He came to save sinners. Why did he come to this world to save sinners? Because he loved sinners. Have you thought about that? He came to this world to save sinners because he loved sinners. Now let's take the New Testament and let's read a few verses that clearly and plainly indicate that to us. Look in Luke, the 7th chapter, in verses 11 to 17, you have the story of the raising of the widow's son at Nain. Her son had died, her only son, she was a widow. It says here, starting in verse 12, as they drew near this city, "Behold, a dead man was being carried out, an only son of his mother, and she was a widow, and there was a great crowd with her. And the Lord seeing her," what does it say he felt like? It says he was moved with compassion. He was moved with compassion upon her, and he said to her, "Stop weeping." And then it tells how it's coming up. He touched the bier. He was moved with compassion. Now, God is not a respecter of persons. He is moved with compassion at the troubles of the children of men. And he was moved with compassion, and it says he came up and he said, "Stop weeping." Look later on in this chapter. Look at verse 39. This is when Mary Magdalene had anointed Jesus with the alabaster oil, from the alabaster box, the oil of nard. And it says in verse 38 that she was wiping off with the head of her hair, he's wiping off his feet and kissing his feet and anointing with the ointment. And then it says in verse 39, "And the Pharisee, seeing," the one who had invited him, "said within himself," spoke within himself, saying, "This one," this person, "if he was a prophet, he would have known what manner of woman this is who has touched him, because she is a sinner." Notice the Pharisees wouldn't even allow a sinner to touch him. And this man, Simon. This man Simon, who was a Pharisee, he said, if this person was a prophet, if Jesus was a prophet, he wouldn't even allow this woman to touch him because she's a sinner. And that's the way the Pharisees treated sinners. If you were considered a sinner by them, they wouldn't allow you to touch them. They wouldn't have anything to do with you. By the way, this woman was not invited to this feast. She slipped in to anoint Jesus. Now, if all you had was your Bible, you would not comprehend the total irony of this story. The irony of this story that is almost beyond human comprehension to understand, but this is the way the human mind is. We are beyond comprehension. The irony of this story is Ellen White says, who was the man that had led Mary into sin? Who was the one that got her in all the trouble in the first place? It was Simon. He was the one that had got her in the mess of her life. And now he's saying if this person was a prophet, he wouldn't even allow her to touch him because she's a sinner. Now let's think that through a little bit. Who's the worst sinner here? Simon's the worst sinner by far. He is not only responsible for leading her into sin, so he's actually more guilty than she. But in addition to that, he's a hypocrite. By the way, friends, hypocrisy is one of the sins that God hates. Because it's associated with pride. It's one of the sins that God hates. It was one of the sins that Lucifer had right at the beginning. Now, what would you do if you were dealing with a scum like that? What would you do? It's interesting to see how Jesus handled this situation. This is a very delicate situation. It says, and Jesus answering said to him, Simon, I have something to say to you. He said, teacher, speak on. There were two debtors to one creditor. Who were the debtors? Simon. And this woman. Who was the creditor? God is the creditor. Every sin that we sin is against God. And there was one, the one owed him 50 denarii and the other 500. Or you can reverse it. The one owed him 500, the one 50. As they didn't have to pay, he freely forgave them both. Therefore, which of them will love him the most? Simon answering said, I suppose that the one to whom he forgave the most. And he said to him, you have rightly judged. And turning toward the woman, to Simon, he said, do you see this woman? I entered into your house. Water for my feet you did not give. But she, with her tears, she wet my feet, and with her hair she wiped them. A kiss to me you did not give. But she, from the time I entered, did not stop fervently kissing my feet. Verse 46. Oil for my head, on my head you did not anoint. But she, with ointment, anointed my feet. For this reason, I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, because she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, loves little. And he said to her, your sins are forgiven. Jesus came into this world to save sinners. He came to save sinners because he loved sinners. And love requires a response. Turn to the Gospel of John, the 13th chapter, where Jesus, just before his betrayal, when he is still in the upper room with the disciples, John 13, he says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. That also you love one another. By this, all shall know that you are disciples to me, if you have love one to another. And friends, this explains the difference between Jesus and us. Helen White talks about this in the book Desire of Ages, page 462, where she says how that Jesus hated sin, but he loved the sinner. And then she says our problem is that we hate the sinner, but we love the sin. We've got everything all upside down. And so what I want to study with you for a few minutes this evening is very, very simple. Just one question. Just one question. And that is, do you love sinners? Do you? Jesus loved sinners. Jesus came into this world to save sinners. He came to this world to save sinners because he loved them, and he was willing to give his life to save sinners. He didn't give his life for people that were righteous. He gave his life for people that were wicked. Jesus loved sinners. Now, our problem is, as human beings, most of us at least, we would much rather love people that are righteous. That was Simon's problem. He said, boy, he was a Pharisee. He said, by the way, Ellen White says the Phariseeism is human nature. So don't just blame the Pharisees. That's human nature to be like the Pharisees. Simon said, if this man was a prophet, he would know that this woman was a sinner and he wouldn't even allow her to touch him. Our problem is, as human beings, most of us, we would much rather love the righteous. We would like for sinners to become righteous first, and then we'll love them. Just look around. That's the way we human beings are. By the way, we don't mind loving the saints. So often when you're doing pastoral work, you run into somebody and they say, well, I thought when I joined the church that this was going to be different. And look at these people you got in here. And sometimes they get so upset with them and say, well, I'm just not going to go to church here. I thought these were the saints. I thought these were people that love the Lord. Look what they're saying. Look at what they're doing. What's the problem? They don't love sinners. They thought that when they joined the church, it was going to be all saints. And they could love saints. They could love saints. But when they come into the church and they find out that the people in the church are sinners, brother, that's too much. Then somebody says something, somebody does something that offends them, and they say, oh, this is the church. You call that an elder? You call that a deacon? So that's our problem. We would rather love the saints. That's why a lot of people leave the church. Because they could love the saints. Wouldn't have any problem loving the saints. But they can't love sinners. That's too much. This is a universal human problem. We would rather love the righteous. We would rather love the saints. By the way, even the devil can do nice things to his own. You don't have to be a Christian to love the saints. In this story in Luke 7 about this sinful woman, she was looked on as a great sinner. Now her sins, Jesus said that her sins were many. But she had learned to love much, and so her sins, which were many, were forgiven. But Jesus said, whom few sins or little sins are forgiven, that person loves little. And Simon was a person who hadn't had very many sins forgiven. He just loved little. We looked at the example of Jesus
with the widow at Nain, how he had compassion on her, and he came to her and he said, stop weeping. Look in Matthew, the 14th chapter, we'll look quickly at a few other examples of the very same thing. Matthew 14. And verse 14. It says, and going out, he saw a great multitude, and he was moved with compassion upon them. And he healed their sick. Now the gospel story is full of stories of Jesus healing the sick. And this tells you why he healed the sick. Why did he heal the sick? Because he was moved with compassion on every sick person. Jesus could not be near a sick person without having sympathy and compassion for that person. All these sick people, by the way, didn't believe on him. Probably the great majority did not believe that he was the Messiah. But he was moved on compassion with them whether they believed on him or not. He loved them whether they loved him or not. Can you do that? Can you love people that don't love you? They're unloving. They're not kind. Seems like when you do something nice for them that you end up maybe even getting stabbed in the back. So we say, well, we're just not going to do anything nice for them anymore. We're tired of getting stabbed in the back. That fixes that. Pretty soon we've crossed so many people off our list, we have not very many people left to be nice to. Does that really happen? That really happens. Because see, we're dealing with sinners. The preachers are sinners, the elders are sinners, the deacons are sinners. The Sabbath school teachers are sinners. The whole church is full of sinners. But Jesus was moved with compassion towards sinners. He loved sinners. Do you love sinners? Do you love sinners even when they sin against you? That's getting close to home, isn't it? It's one thing to love sinners when they sin against somebody else. How about when they sin against me? Do I love them then? Look in Mark 10. Mark 10. Let's start reading in verse 19. This is Jesus talking to the rich man, the rich young ruler, as we call him. He says to him, starting in verse 19, he says, you know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Do not defraud. Honor your father and your mother. And he gave answer to him, teacher, all these things I've kept from my youth. And Jesus, looking on him, what does it say he did? He loved him. He loved him. Now this man was a great sinner too. And his problem was he didn't have any idea that he was a great sinner. He thought that he was a righteous man, but he wasn't. Because he was selfish. Selfishness is the root of every sin. And he was full of selfishness. But he told the Lord, I've kept the law. In one sentence, Jesus is going to reveal to him his condition. The reason Jesus was going to reveal to him his condition is because he loved him. It says he loved him. Isn't that what it says? You know, friend, God loves you so much. It says in 1 Corinthians 13, love does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but it rejoices in the truth. God loves you so much that he's going to let you know the truth about yourself. And when you find out the truth about yourself, you're not going to enjoy it. Nobody in this world does. But God loves you so much, he's not going to play any game with you. He's not going to tell you everything's all right when it's not all right. He's going to tell you the truth. This man was lost, but he thought he was a righteous man. So in one sentence, Jesus is going to, he's going to find out what his real condition is. So, it says, Jesus looking on him loved him, and he said to him, you lack one thing. Go and whatever you have, sell it, and give to the poor. And you will have treasure in heaven. And come follow me. And he, being sad at this word, went away grieving, for he had great possessions. You'll never find this man in the kingdom of heaven. He won't be there. This world was his God. He was selfish. Notice here in this passage of Scripture, verses 19 to 21 or 22 that we read, that the idea of love and the idea of keeping the commandments is linked together. That is something that is linked together in the words and teachings of Jesus and even in the Old Testament. Jesus said to the disciples in John 14:15, he said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Love and keeping the commandments is united in the Bible. Now, some people today are very confused. A large part of the Christian world is very confused, and they say to us, they say, oh, you're legalists. They say that the law was nailed to the cross. What they don't understand is that the Bible teaches that there were two codes of law. There was a code of law that was nailed to the cross. But it wasn't the Ten Commandments that Jesus was quoting here. This is so important to understand that the law and love are linked together and to understand the difference between the moral law and the ceremonial law. We should spend just 3 or 4 or 5 minutes showing the difference between the two codes of law. Here they are, 12 different points. Number one, there was one law that was added because of transgression. That's Galatians 3:19. It was added because of transgression. But that was not the moral law. Was the Sabbath added because of transgression? Why, no. You can read about the Sabbath in Genesis 2, verses 1 to 3, before there ever was any transgression. The Sabbath wasn't added because of transgression. It was given before there ever was any transgression. How about the rest of the moral law? Well, the Sabbath is just one part of one law. The whole Ten Commandments is one law. The Ten Commandments is not 10 laws. The Ten Commandments is just one law. You can read that in Exodus 24:12. The Ten Commandments are spoken of as one law, not 10 laws. Exodus 24:12. So there was one law that was added because of transgression. But there was one law that Paul said if there was no law, there wouldn't even be any transgression. Have you read that? Romans 4:15. Without the law, there wouldn't even been a transgression. Without the Ten Commandment law, there wouldn't even have been a transgression. In fact, Paul says, I wouldn't even know what sin was without the law. Romans 7:7. And Jesus said, talked about it, being forever. Okay, now we're coming to point number two. Point number one, there was one law that was added because of transgression. But there was one law that sin wouldn't even have existed. There wouldn't even have been transgression if that law hadn't already been there. So it was before sin was. Otherwise, there wouldn't have been sin. That's point number one. Point number two, there was one law that was a shadow of things to come. There was one law that was a shadow of things to come. Paul speaks of that repeatedly in Colossians 2 and in Hebrews 10. But there was another law that was not a shadow of anything, but it was a memorial. It was a memorial of creation, and it existed since creation of the world. You can read that right in the fourth commandment. Point number three. There was one law. It says in Galatians 3:19 that it was added because of transgression. But then it says it was added because of transgression till the seed should come. It was added until the seed should come. In other words, it was going to be done away with at the cross of Christ. But there was another law that wasn't until the seed should come. It was forever. In fact, Jesus said, concerning that law in Luke 16:17. He said, till heaven and earth passed. And then if I just put it in modern English, he said, even a part of a letter, not a whole letter, even a part of a letter will not be done away from that law. He said it would be easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for a part of a letter of that law to fail. Now that's about as strong a language as you can use. That's in Luke 16:17. The Father used just as strong a language. He said, I will not change that which has gone out of my lips. I won't alter my covenant. I won't change it. It will not be changed. That's in Psalm 89:34. So there was one law that was added until the seed should come. It was added after transgression. It would exist till the seed should come. There was another law that existed before transgression, or there wouldn't even be transgression, and it is forever. Jesus said it would be easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for a part of a letter of that law to fail. Is the heaven and earth still here? Well, if the heaven and earth is still here, then that law is still here, every single letter. Maybe look at three things. Look at four. Number four. There was one law that was handwritten. It is called the handwriting of the ordinances in the New Testament. It was handwritten. You can read that in Deuteronomy 31:24. It was handwritten. There was another law that was not handwritten, but it was written by the finger of God, Deuteronomy 9:10. Number five. There was a law that was abolished when Christ came and died on the cross, as you can read in Ephesians 2:15. But there was another law that was established by Christ coming and dying on the cross. His death on the cross proved that it could not be changed, because if it could have been changed, he would not have needed to die for our sins. Sin is the transgression of the law. If that law could have been changed for just a few minutes in the Garden of Eden, Jesus would not have had to come and die on the cross. But that law could not be changed. Not only could it not be changed, even the penalty could not be remitted. That's why Jesus had to die on the cross for your sins, for mine. Number six, there is a law that is called in the New Testament the law of a carnal, that's a fleshly, commandment. That's Hebrews 7:16. But there's another law that's not carnal or fleshly at all. It's referred to as being spiritual, as you can read in Romans 7:14. There's one that's a carnal commandment. There's one commandment that's spiritual. Number seven, there was a law that was changed by Christ coming. That's Hebrews 7:12. But there is another law that can never be changed. We already referred to that in Psalm 89:34 and Luke 16:17. Number eight, there was a law. The Bible says it was written by Moses. You can read that in Deuteronomy 31:24. But there was another law that was not written by Moses. It was written by God himself, as you can read in Deuteronomy 9:10. Number nine, there was a law that was written in a book. The Bible says so, Deuteronomy 31:24. But there was another law that was not written in a book. It was written in stone. You can read that in Deuteronomy 10:4 and 5. And then, number 10, there was a law that was placed in the side of the ark. That's Deuteronomy 31:26. But there was a law that was not placed in the side of the ark. It was placed in the ark itself, as you can read in Deuteronomy 10, verses 4 and 5. And then there was a law that was a yoke of bondage. The New Testament is very clear on this. So is Ellen White, by the way. You can read it in Acts 15, verses 1 and 10. You can read it in Galatians 5, verses 1 to 3. You can read it in Galatians 4, 25. There was a law that was a yoke of bondage. That was a ceremonial law. But there is another law that is called the law of liberty in James 2:12. And if you read the context of James 2:12, you can see exactly what law he's talking about. He's talking about the Ten Commandments. And finally, number 12. There was a law that was ceremonial. That is, it had to do with religious ceremonies. It involved the earthly sanctuary, a Levitical priesthood, animal sacrifices, feasts, drink offerings, meat offerings, all kinds of religious service. It was ceremonial. You can read about that in Colossians 2 or in Hebrews 9. But there was another law that was not ceremonial. It was moral. Because Paul says in Romans 7, he says, I would not even know what sin is without the law. In other words, this law defines right and wrong. That's what moral is. Moral is something that's right or wrong. If it's moral, it's right. And if it's immoral, it's wrong. The moral law defines right and wrong. And Paul says, I wouldn't even know what sin was if it wasn't for the law. So when people come to you and they say, well, there's just one law in the Bible. Oh, no, friends. I just gave you 12 lines of evidence. There's not just one law. There's two laws. One was a ceremonial law. It was temporary. It ended at the cross. We need to spend a few more minutes on this because there's some people that are so utterly confused. I want to read to you just, we'll limit it to three. Three statements from the Spirit of Prophecy on this subject so that you'll understand. You'll be ready to answer when people come to you with the heresy of keeping feast days. Listen to this. Review and Herald, June 14, 1898. It was Christ's desire to leave to his disciples an ordinance that would do for them the very thing they needed, that would serve to disentangle them from the rites and ceremonies which they had hitherto engaged in as essential and which the reception of the gospel made no longer of any force. To continue these rites would be an insult to Jehovah. Pretty strong language, isn't it? If you continue keeping those rites of the ceremonial law, what does it say? It's an insult to Jehovah. Why is it an insult to Jehovah? Because those point forward to Christ. And when you keep those rites, you're in effect saying you're still looking for a Messiah to come. It's an insult, she says, to Jehovah to continue those rites. Here's another one. In this ordinance, that's the ordinance of foot washing, Christ discharged his disciples from the cares and burdens of the ancient Jewish obligations in rites and ceremonies. These no longer possessed any virtue, for type was meeting antitype in himself. That's Review and Herald also, June 14, 1898. And here's one from Review and Herald, June 21, 1892. It says, the great teacher's wisdom in limiting the measure of our researches in earthly directions called the attention of all to his legislation from the very foundation of our world to a code of morals. What would that code of morals be? The Ten Commandments. Pure, simple, and practical, unencumbered by the long years of types and sacrifices which passed away when the only true sacrifice, Jesus, the only begotten Son of God, was offered for the sins of the world. His lessons to his disciples are received by all who would become his disciples to the end of time. These lessons, now listen carefully, these lessons discharge his followers from the bondage of the ceremonial law and leave them the ordinance of baptism to be received by repentance and faith in Jesus Christ as the only one who can take away sin. So, friends, there is one law that's been done away. It's not the Ten Commandments. It's a ceremonial law, sometimes called the Law of Moses. Now, I gave myself this. I want to give you an opportunity to give yourself this. I call this a self-test. Now, we're all going to go to the Day of Judgment, and we're going to all be tested, but good to give ourselves a self-test before we get there. Have you ever given yourself a self-test before you took the real test? I will not take the time to tell you any stories about that, but if there's anybody here and you're going to be going to college or graduate school, that's one of the ways that's been proven over and over again. The way to do very excellent in your tests in college is to give yourself a self-test over the material you're going to know you're going to be tested over. And if you can do it for yourself, you'll be able to do it at test time. Here's a self-test. And the question is simply one question. Do I love sinners? Do I love sinners? Not the sinners that are my friends, the sinners that are my enemies. Well, here's some questions you can ask yourself. Number one, my thoughts. What are my thoughts? Not my thoughts toward my friends, but my thoughts toward my enemies. Now, there is a result of our thoughts. After we think about something for a while, those thoughts result in feelings. So the second question is, what are my feelings? What are my feelings toward my enemies? Here in Luke 6, Jesus gets to talking about this in the Sermon on the Mount. Luke 6. Here's a third question. My speech. First, your thoughts. Your thoughts result in feelings. But eventually, your thoughts and feelings are going to result in words. That's just the way we're made. Jesus said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. What is my speech about my enemies? Here, look at Luke 6, 27 and 28. But I say to you that here, love your enemies. Do good to those that hate you. Bless those that curse you. Pray on behalf of those who insult you. How is it? How are your thoughts? How are your feelings? How are your words? Not toward your friends. Don't worry about that. The devil can treat his friends nice if he wants to. But Jesus said, love your enemies and do good to those that hate you and bless those that curse you. Pray for those that insult you. What are my thoughts toward my enemies? What are my feelings? What is my speech? You know, something that has been of a great, very great comfort to me for a long time. I really don't know how many times I've thanked the Lord for this. But you know, when I get to the day of judgment, I am not going to have to answer one word about what my enemy said about me. Am I ever glad of that? Thank the Lord for that many times. I won't have to answer a thing. No matter what they've said, no matter what they thought, felt, done against me, I won't have to answer. All I have to answer for is how did I think, how did I feel, how did I speak, how did I act toward my enemies? I don't have to answer about anything they said or did toward me. I don't have to answer for that. The problem is, I think you'll agree that for most of us, it's going to be a plenty big job to just answer for what we've said. What have we done? What have we thought? What have we felt? Look what the Apostle Paul says about this in Romans 13. I think it's Romans 13, or is it 12? I'm sorry, I gave you the wrong chapter. It's Romans 12. He says here in Romans 12, starting in the 9th verse, he says, let love be without hypocrisy, abhorring the evil and clinging to the good. Have brotherly love toward each other, loving fervently in honor, preferring one another. And then he says at the last of the chapter, he says to overcome. You see in verse 21? He says, do not be conquered by evil, but conquer the evil by that which is good. And then in chapter 13, he says in verse 10, he says, love does not do any evil to his neighbor. Therefore, Love is the fulfillment of the law. Look back over to chapter 12 again. He talks about giving place for wrath. You see that in verse 19. And he says in verse 19 that we don't have to avenge ourselves because the Lord is going to repay. But then notice what he says in verse 20. But if your enemy is hungry, give him something to eat. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. For doing this, you shall heap coals of fire upon his head. That's the Christian religion. The Christian religion doesn't deal so much with how you deal with your friends. It deals with, do you love sinners, even the sinners that have sinned against you? Do you love your enemies? Now I want to ask you a hard question. And it is this. Why is there so much strife among Christians? Oh, somebody says, it's because we don't have unity of belief. Are you sure? I don't believe so. Now, it would be nice if we had unity of belief. But let me ask you this question. Have you ever seen any people that had unity of belief and still had strife? Have you ever seen that? Well, if they have unity of belief and if they believe the same and they're still fighting, then what's the cause of the strife? Why is there so much strife among Christians? You see, the root cause of our strife is not because we don't understand theology exactly the same. That's not the root cause. It's not because we don't have unity of belief. No. The reason that there is so much strife among Christians, shall we say it straight, is because we don't love each other. That's why. That's why. We don't have thoughts toward our enemies like the Good Samaritan had toward his enemy. We don't have feelings toward our enemy like Jesus had toward Simon. Did you notice how Jesus did not embarrass Simon in front of his company, even though he was a scum, a scoundrel? He didn't embarrass him. We don't have feelings like that toward those that have wronged us. And so, in our speech, we get all riled up. We speak against each other. Our actions aren't right. And then we get to fighting. Then we have strife. Remember, you do not have to answer in the judgment about how your enemies think about you. You don't have to answer in the judgment how they feel about you. You don't have to answer in the judgment what they say about you or what they do to you. You don't have to answer about any of those things. All you have to answer for in the judgment is how you think about them, how you feel toward them, how you speak about them, and how you act toward them. According to 1 John 3:16, we are to be willing to die for our brothers. And friends, I'm just a human being and I'm not a prophet. So I'm not telling you this like a prophet. I'm just telling you this as a human being that's made the observation. You can decide whether it's true or not. My observation is I don't think that we love each other enough to die for each other yet, because if we did, we wouldn't treat each other the way we're treating each other. Even if we were enemies with each other, we wouldn't treat each other like we do. We wouldn't talk about each other the way we do. Some of you might remember 2 years or more ago, I told a story when I was preaching right here one Sabbath morning about, you see, I had read something in the Review and Herald. And what I had read in the Review and Herald was that there was a certain church. And in this church, they decided that everybody in this church was going to read from the King James Version. By the way, just a few days ago, I told those in our staff, where I found out that there is a church in the United States, an independent Seventh-day Adventist church, that has decided that if you don't read from the King James Version in their church, they'll disfellowship you. They actually moved to disfellowship somebody. that person and that family decided that it would be better not to have strife over that, so they decided to leave that church. But anyway, I was telling the story right here of what I had read in the Review and Herald about this church that decided that they were going to only read the King James Version in this church, and they got together all their New International Version Bibles and they burned them. And I was so appalled when I read this that I announced it right in our church service, and it was videotaped. And I said, now, if in your church, if you decide that you're going to get rid of all these translations, I said, please don't burn them. I said, please send them to me. I'll send them to Africa. We have more people writing to us for Bibles from Africa than we have Bibles to send them to. Before you burn your versions up, send them to me, and I'll send them to Africa. Somebody over there that doesn't have a Bible will have a Bible. Wouldn't that be good? I thought it would be. I said, that way you'll have stars in your crown instead of smoke up your chimney. Well, that was videotaped. I got some communication out of that, believe me. I was informed that if I sent New International Version Bibles over to Africa, that I would be sending those people to hell. And I thought, what is this? Why are we treating each other like this? You mean if that was the only Bible somebody had, you would rather burn it up than allow them to have that? Guess so. How do we get into such fanaticism? The reason we get into fanaticism... By the way, I'm not defending the New International Version. Those of you that come to church here know I've never preached out of the International Version even once the whole time I've been here. I don't think I've ever had one copy in the pulpit, ever once. I wasn't promoting it. But I'd rather that somebody have one of those to read than have no Bible at all. How do we get into such fanaticism? We have more fanaticism in Christianity at large and in Adventism in particular, and in historic Adventism in particular. We have more fanaticism than any time in the past that I can remember. How do we have so much fanaticism, and why do we have so much fanaticism? Do you know what one of the biggest reasons is? Because we don't love one another. If we really loved each other enough to die for each other, and we talked things over with brotherly love, we might have differences of opinion. But we would not be having the fanaticism that we're having. One of the biggest reasons for the fanaticism that is all over today is because of our lack of love for each other. That's one of the biggest reasons. In Luke 22, at the time when Jesus was instituting the Lord's Supper, the disciples had strife and fighting among themselves. By the way, they had a problem with fanaticism among the 12 disciples. If you hadn't studied about that, that's not our subject, but they had that problem too. They had one of their members who was called Simon the Canaanite sometimes. Sometimes he was called Simon the Zealot. Do you know what the Zealots were? You know who they were? The Zealots were people who believed that the Jews needed to arm and they needed to overthrow the Romans by military force. That's who they were. They were for having an armed revolt and overthrowing the power of Rome. That was the Zealots. One of those were Jesus' disciples. Peter would have been right along with them too, because he had a sword. He wasn't afraid to use it either. And so they were fighting. They had fanaticism. They were fighting. They had strife. You can read about it here in Luke, the 22nd chapter. It's verses 24 to 30. The story of them striving amongst themselves. And Jesus appealed to them to be at peace. That's why Jesus got up and washed their feet, to humble them. But we are in trouble in Christendom today. We're in trouble in Adventism today. We think that our trouble is because of all the heretics out there and the fanaticism and all those things, and those are indeed troubles, all right. But underneath that, at the bottom of our trouble, and the thing that would solve most of the other troubles that we have, is the problem that we don't love each other like Jesus loved us. That is our fundamental root problem. And friends, if we could get that problem solved, there's a whole bunch of other problems that we have that would immediately be solved right away. Have you studied Luke, or not Luke, have you studied 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 to 7 real carefully? Concerning love, it says that it does not become irritated. What would that do for us? I think the King James Version says does not become provoked. That means irritated. That's what that word means, irritated. Love does not become irritated. Jesus loved sinners. The question is, do I love sinners? Do you know, until I love sinners, I can't go to heaven? I'm not ready yet. Until I love sinners, I'm not ready to go to heaven. I'm not fitted for heaven. I have to get that love in my heart. I have to have, that's what the new heart is all about, so that I'll get over my selfishness and begin to love sinners. Let me read that to you in closing. First of all, from Desire of Ages, page 641, it says, love to man is the earthward manifestation of love to God. It was to implant this love, to make us children of one family, that the King of Glory became one with us. And when his parting words are fulfilled, love one another as I have loved you, John 1 John 15, when we love the world as he has loved it, then for us his mission is accomplished. We are fitted for heaven, for we have heaven in our hearts. When is it that I'm fitted for heaven? When I love others, when I love the world as he loved it, then for me, his mission is accomplished. Then I'm fitted to go to heaven. I already have heaven inside. Hope you'll think about that. Are you ready to go to heaven? You and I are not ready to go to heaven until we love the world the way Jesus loved it. And when we do love the world the way Jesus loved it, then we have reached spiritual perfection. You know, I can remember about 25 years ago or 28 years ago when we had a huge debate in Adventism over perfection. Do any of you here remember when we had that huge debate over perfection in the 1970s? A huge debate when theologians, they wrote a whole book about it on perfection. Two theologians wrote in favor of it and two theologians wrote against it. Some said, yes, but we must be perfect, and the other people said, no, we can't be perfect. We had a huge debate. What does it mean to be perfect? When you love the world the way Jesus loved it, you are perfect. If you want to see that in your Bible, read Matthew 5, 43 to 48. When you love your enemies, then you will be perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. That's the criteria. Read Matthew 5, 43 to 48. Look at verse 48. Don't read that all by itself. It has a context. Read the previous five verses. When we love the world as he loved it, that's when we have spiritual perfection. Just think it through. When you love the world the way he loved it, you'll have every other character trait that you need. You're perfect. His mission for you is accomplished. You're ready to go to heaven. Here's one more. This is from the Southern Watchman, November 5, 1907. It says, the heart of God is moved. Souls are very precious in his sight. It was for this world that Christ wept in agony. For this world that he was crucified. God gave his only begotten Son to save sinners. And he desires us to love others as he loved us. He wants me to love others how? The way he loved me. Oh, friend, you and I, this is not something that's optional. This is an experience you and I have to have if we're going to be saved. We have to have it. But the Lord can give it to us if we'll cooperate. Do you love sinners? Oh, not your friends, your enemies. Do you love sinners? Do you love sinners the way Jesus loved sinners? When you do, then you're perfect. When you do, then you're ready to go to heaven. When you do, Jesus can take you out of this world. You want to be ready? Well, a question to ask yourself, just one. Do you love sinners? When you love sinners the way Jesus loved sinners, His mission for you is accomplished. You're fitted for heaven. You're ready to go. Do you want that experience? Let's pray and ask the Lord to give it to us. Father in heaven, we dare not spend time looking at our own natural heart because we realize that we are wretched. We are by nature selfish, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. But Lord, you have told us to come to you so that we could receive the gold of that faith and love that Jesus had in his heart, that white raiment that was his righteousness. Open our eyes so that we can see spiritual reality. And oh, Father in heaven, we pray that you will convert us, that you will give us a new heart. Help us by your grace that we may learn to love sinners the way Jesus loved sinners, that we may love the world the way he loved it, that we may love others the way you loved us. Lord, we know when this happens that the strife among your people is going to stop. And Lord, we want to see a complete change in our own hearts, and we want to see a complete change among your professed people so that the work can be finished, so that Jesus can come. So Lord, what we've studied tonight, help it not just to be a story or a theology, but we pray that it may be an experience that each one of us here does experience, that there may be not just a revival, but a reformation of character, that we might become Christ-like. Oh Lord, help us to learn how to treat each other the way Jesus would treat us if he were here. Help us to treat our enemies the way he treated his enemies. We pray that you will work in each of our hearts this complete transformation of character so that we will be ready for Jesus to come, so that we will be a perfect reflection of his divine character. We pray in his name and for his sake. Amen.
Steps to Life.
We hope you have been as blessed by today's message as we have been in bringing it to you. We encourage you to contact us at Steps to Life Ministries with any questions or comments you might have.
Check 1, 2. Check 1, 2.
Don't forget to ask for today's free offer.
Ready in 5, 4.
Steps to Life Ministries, preparing a people for the soon coming of Jesus Christ.
Welcome, friends.